So I'd like to thank the organizers for inviting me to this nice conference and nice place. So I'm going to talk about wellposedness and the scattering question for the Zakharov system in space four dimensions. This is a joint work with Ioan Bejenaru, Zihua and Sebastian Herr. He's there, yes. Okay. So let me start with the equation. This is a kind of a classical nonlinear dispersive equation, which is a system of Schrödinger equation and the wave equation. And it's a kind of model equation for the plasma, which is called Langmuir turbulence, essentially generated by the nonlinear interaction between electric oscillations and hydrodynamic oscillation. So here, Hugh is somehow describing a slow motion of the electric field, and N is describing the motion of ion density. So it is a space-time function, U is a complex and N is a real. Here alpha is a parameter which will be fixed throughout the this talk. It's a kind of, it's a positive constant for the ion speed, sound speed. Anyway, so this is our equation. The main result is a kind of classical question and simple. We consider this specifically in space dimension 4 and prove some local and global existence, more precisely Wellposedness result, together with scattering to free state as time goes to infinity. So this dimension 4 is kind of weird for this model because this is physics in the real three-dimensional space. So usually people consider this only in three dimension or lower. But somehow we find an interesting mathematical question in this special dimension because it brings several sort of criticality for the analysis. So just for simplicity of the notation, it is better to transform the wave equation into the first order. Just by decomposing as usual to the incoming and outgoing waves, so that we can regard it's a kind of Schrödinger type equation. Then we have this type of system of first order equations. And so capital N is just a complexified wave component. And small n is the real part. Then let me review some basic facts of the Zakharov system. First of all, it is a Hamiltonian system, and the Hamiltonian is given in this form. And the mass, or the L2 norm for the Schrödinger component is also preserved. Therefore, as a solution space or the function space for the initial data, the most natural choice is to choose the Schrödinger component from H1 and the wave component from L2, so that we can make sense of both quantities, at least in lower dimensions. And then you immediately see already here, the four dimension is a kind of critical case, because to make sense the energies in this H1 cross L2 space, you need to control the nonlinearity. And then just by using the Herr and the Sobolev inequality, this can be controlled if and only if the dimension is 4 or less. And the dimension 4 is the critical case where this has essentially the same scaling. However, since our equation is not scaling invariant, it is not very clear what is the scaling critical exponent. However, if you take the so-called subsonic limit, where you regard that the motion is much slower than the sound speed, or mathematically it corresponds to taking the limit alpha going to infinity, then because we have this equation for the wave component, if you send formally alpha to infinity, then you see that n should be equal to u square. Then plugging this into the first equation, you get simply the standard focusing cubic nonlinear Schrödinger equation. And for this equation, it is scaling invariant, and well known that this is critical in the energy space for four dimensions. So in this case, it is clearly scaling critical as long as we want to have solutions in the energy space. That's the first thing. However, at least from technical viewpoint, the Zakharov system is even more critical than the Schrödinger equation. And it is more related to the use of Stricker's estimate. And here, somehow, because it is a system of the wave and the Schrödinger equation, the exponents which we can use for the Stricker's estimate is somehow limited. And we are forced to use the endpoint Stricker's estimate. It is in 4D, L2 in time and L4 in X. And this is the exponent if you consider L2 solutions. If you consider H1 solution, then you get one regularity in this space. So you consider the first derivative in L4 in space. Then again, this space is critical, and it's even more critical in the sense that the Sobolev embedding fails, because this corresponds to the case where it should be embedded into L infinity, but this is well known to be false. And this causes a lot of trouble, at least if we go in a straightforward way. So let me just recall other difficulties, which are actually somehow classical and essentially solved before. However, it is not only for the four-dimensional case, but in general for the Zakharov system. First problem is for the local existence of solutions. Even for the local existence, it is slightly more difficult than the Schrödinger equation, in the sense that, or just the wave equation, in the sense that the nonlinearity has the derivative. And so, for example, if you consider the simplest estimate, that's just you estimate the right-hand side by the linear energy inequality, then you lose the regularity because of this derivative on the nonlinearity. That can be easily seen because for the first order equation, if you apply the energy inequality, then it means the right-hand side or the source term should have the same regularity as the solution. Then, for example, you assume that your solution is in HS space for S large enough. Then U square is in HS, therefore the derivative of U square should be HS minus 1. And that implies the wave component should have one less regularity. However, if you plug it into here, then N times U would have HS minus 1 regularity, and you cannot go back to HS for the Schrödinger component. But this is a well-known problem in the Zakharov system, or in general for this kind of equation. And in particular for the Zakharov system, this can be easily solved by a few different methods, taking account that the nonlinear part, the interaction is not really resonant, meaning this two product of two functions do not really interact if you take account of the oscillation. And there are easy ways to remove this problem. Another possible problem is for large data. If you want to have scattering theory in the Sobolev space, then there is a clear lower bound for the low decay of nonlinear term as U goes to zero. And so it is given for the Schrödinger equation by the power which is called the L2 critical power, 1 plus 4 over d. So this is a main problem if you consider three-dimensional or lower-dimensional case. However, 4d is luckily on the borderline case, where so when d is 4, this is just 2, and we have a quadratic interaction. So from this, you do not really expect that the nonlinear interaction causes a big trouble. However, you can see, so this is again a kind of critical case, but this is not really so much critical because by taking account of the nonlinear non-resonance property of the equation, our nonlinearity is not as strong as quadratic interaction for the Schrödinger. Therefore, this problem is not so much relevant. Okay, now let me show you our result. It's a very simple statement, although the range of exponent is a bit complicated. You don't have to consider this, but I will show you later the picture. So for some range of exponent, S is for Schrödinger component, and sigma is for the wave component. We can prove first the scattering, global wellposedness and the scattering at time infinity for small data. So for any data in the Sobolev space, HS for the Schrödinger component, H sigma for the wave component, and if you assume it is sufficiently small in a kind of critical space, so this regularity 1/2 and 0 is the weakest possible choice in this range. Then we have a global unique solution which continuously depends on the initial data, and as time goes to infinity, it converges, it is asymptotic to a free solution. So this is a very classical statement of small data scattering. So as I said, 1/2 and 0 is the lowest number in this range. So this is the first result. I should mention that energy space is when S is 1 and sigma is 0. It is one of the extremal points of this region. Okay. Then that was for small data. For large data, we can construct time local solutions unless the exponent is in the energy space. So except for this special case, for the other range of exponents, we have local solutions for the same initial for the initial data in the same space, but not necessarily small. So this is a simple local wellposedness result, and we have also illposedness result when the wave component is required to have higher regularity. This is another corner extremal point of our range. And at this point, we have illposedness, which is kind of quite strong. You can regard it as either non-existence of a solution or loss of regularity immediately after time zero. So the precise statement is that you can find some initial data, and even for a one parameter of initial data, there is no solution in the appropriate function space, which should be there if we had the local wellposedness, and we can even weaken the requirement for the solution. It is just a distributional solution with much lower regularity than the initial data. Even with this assumption, we can prove that there is no such solution. And however, since this exponent is relatively high, actually there is a unique solution in a different function space. Indeed, the main problem here is that the wave component is required to have too much regularity compared with the Schrödinger component. And indeed, we can construct this result implies that our solution is, for example, in H2 cross H2. But this solution is not in the same space as the initial data, H3, as soon as the time is different from zero. So somehow the solution instantaneously exits the initial data space. So in this sense, this is a very strong illposedness result. Okay, so they are our results. And so let me quickly recall some previous results and some independent similar result. Concerning Wellposedness, local Wellposedness, there was a result by Brugan and Coriander. So they consider three-dimensional or lower, and then they proved local Wellposedness in the energy space, as well as global existence for small data in the energy space. So this is in the line as Brugan's results for nonlinear Schrödinger equation using XSP space. And then it was later extended by Ginibre, Tsutsumi and Velo to wider to more general range of exponents, as well as for general space dimensions. And it was further improved by Bejenaru, Herr, Kolmar, Tatar in 2D, and Bejenaru, Herr in 3D to the even lower regularity. I don't make it specific, but okay. So here is the range in the Ginibre, Tsutsumi and Velo in four dimension. The endpoint is 1/2 and 0, and there is 1 and 0. This is the energy space, but the line connecting them is not was not included. And this is 1 and 1, and there is a strip of parallel lines. So our result is extending the region. So these blue lines was were in the Ginibre, Tsutsumi and Velo. So we are able to include these two edges, and in particular 1/2 and 0, as well as the energy space. And we can also extend the region to the both sides, where the either Schrödinger component has more regularity or the wave component has more regularity. And this 2 and 3 was another corner point, extremal point, where we have the illposedness. Okay, so this is about local illposedness. And for large time behavior, there were several results concerning the scattering theory. But starting with a free profile given at time infinity, and you try to construct a unique solution asymptotic to that. So it's a construction of the wave operator. It was considered mainly in 3D. So first, Ozawa and Tsutsumi proved such a result in weighted Sobolev space, either assuming that the final data was small, or there is some non-resonant condition on the asymptotic profile. So this Xi being alpha is somehow strongly resonant, because where Schrödinger component and wave component propagates in the same speed. So they assume that component is vanishing at the time infinity. It was kind of a non-generic condition. It was proved removed later by Shimomura, but he had to assume another condition on the Fourier component, Fourier transform of the wave component, that is vanishing of the zero frequency. So in this sense, so this kind of condition often appears in the construction of wave operators, but this also means that data was not generic. And finally, it was removed by Ginibre and Velo, and they were also able to extend the function space for the final state. It was essentially a kind of Sobolev space based on L2 and L1. And they considered also two dimension, but I don't know any paper about four dimension. So another direction is the blow up results. We don't have such result, but I just mentioned. In 2D, there is a result by Grangedast and Merl. They constructed blow-up solution in finite time using the critical, nonlinear Schrödinger equation as an approximate. And for 2D and 3D, Merl also proved for negative energy, the solution blows up either in finite time or in infinite time. But I guess the three-dimensional case, the existence is still open, right? And for scattering, starting from the initial data, it's a relatively recent progress, as far as I know. So in 3D with the Guo, we proved the scattering result as in our result here in 3D, but assuming radial symmetry and in the energy space. And almost simultaneously, around the same time, Hani, Pusateri, and Shatar proved without assuming symmetry, but imposing decay at space infinity. And then with Guo, Li, and Wang, we somehow improved our first result by removing the radial symmetry, but assuming that the angular derivative is also in the, in the energy space. So if the data is sufficiently decaying at infinity, of course, the angular derivative is fine. And in particular, these two results are contained in this case. In the 4D case, I don't know other result, but Kato and Tsugawa obtained independently essentially the same result. However, they had to they consider only on this diagonal case, which is this green line starting from the lowest regularity point, and the proof is different. Okay, so this is a quick review about the previous result. So let me talk about some ideas in the proof. Indeed, our proof is pretty simple, and essentially it's classical and known arguments. So first we use, in order to treat this problem of derivative loss, we use the argument known from Shatar. It is just by using integration by parts to remove some nonlinear interaction which is oscillatory in time. So it can formulate as follows. You first consider the Fourier transform of each space, each solution, and filter the free evolution, or you filter out the free oscillation from the solutions. Then the remainder is supposed to oscillate slowly in time. And you can inject just this expression into the Duhamel formula in the Fourier side, then to extract the time oscillation compared with the free evolution, and you immediately see that it is given by this formula. So of course, in for general xi and eta, you may have a bit complicated set of zero of this function, but here we just need to consider the case when the wave component has higher frequency, because a wave component is expected to have lower regularity than the Schrödinger equation by the previous argument. So if you assume that the wave component has much higher regularity, then you can essentially ignore eta, and then this is just xi square minus xi square plus alpha xi. So this can vanish only if xi is the same size as alpha. This is the same set as in the result of Ozawa Tsutsumi. If you avoid this special set, then this oscillation in time is always large. And if you go higher frequency, it grows like xi square. And this means if you integrate in time, then you gain 1 over xi square. It's like inverse of minus Laplacian. So you gain a lot of regularity by this oscillation in time. And also, by this partial integration, you either differentiate this part by time, or you get some boundary term of the integral. That means you gain also decay in time, because you either remove the integral, or by differentiation, you use the equation, and then you get the cubic nonlinearity. So just by using this simple argument, we can transform our equation, which is a bit ugly, but much better than before. And so it is essentially of this form. We lift some part of the interaction, which is when the wave component has lower frequency, but the other part is coming from this integration by parts is cubic. And there is some quadratic part, but for which we don't have time integral. And then for this equation is essentially like nonlinear Schrödinger equation in the sense that you don't have to take care of the regularity, semilinear Schrödinger equation. And so For example, if you assume that the wave component is in L2 and the Schrödinger component is in HS, then you can estimate it by very simple Herder type inequality. For example, for this part, HS and 4 over 3 in L4 over 3 is just Herder inequality. And since n is low frequency, the derivative hits only on the Schrödinger component. For the components which we applied partial integration, the regularity, the derivative is hitting the wave component. However, here we have minus Laplace inverse thanks to this integration by parts. So it is even better that the derivative hits the wave component, and essentially the same Herder type inequality works. And this allows us to go from L4 to L4 thirds. These exponents appear in the endpoint Stricker's estimate. More precisely, we need to use Kaufman-Meier bilinear Fourier multiplier estimates, but it's essentially like Herder inequality. And this is particularly simple because we are putting the wave component in L2. And here we gain two derivatives. That means this part is essentially like H2. And H2 is embedded into L infinity almost in 4D. That's why we get a very simple numerology here. However, you should note that this is not embedded into L infinity. It is again a critical property of our argument, and in particular, this estimate fails if you choose the Schrödinger component in H1. But as long as S is below 1, these estimates are good enough. Of course, we need to take care about the wave component, wave equation. But anyway, a very simple Herder type estimate together with endpoint Stricker's estimate, which is if you have the Schrödinger equation in the dual space, L2 in time, L4 thirds in space, then you get your solution in L2 in time, L4 in space. Just by this estimate, we can get a closed estimate, and by iteration, we get solution. But as I said, this estimates just fails at the energy space. Typically, these two estimates are simply false if we choose S equals 1. And this is because we cannot put the lower frequency part into L infinity. So it is more, it is not for this part, but more precisely this, because of this. As I said, it is related to the endpoint Stricker's estimate and together with the failure of Sobolev inequality. So you might wonder, maybe you should change the estimate for the wave component, but there is absolutely no other choice for the wave component if it has zero regularity. Because, for example, if you use the Stricker's estimate for the wave component, then you are going to lose some regularity because the regularity for the Schrödinger Stricker's is always better than the wave Stricker's estimate. And so if it's just on the borderline, if you shift slightly to the wave, then you immediately lose the closed estimate. That's why we have to stick to the endpoint Stricker's estimate. That's the best regularity for the Schrödinger Stricker's estimate. However, if we have more regularity for the Schrödinger component, we can do that. So we can somehow sacrifice part of regularity by Schrödinger Stricker's, and instead we use the Stricker's estimate for the wave equation. That is why we can somehow go slightly to the exponents where Schrödinger component is better. Although in this case, we need to use, we have to restrict the range of Stricker's norm in our estimate. I don't get into much detail, but in particular, we cannot prove that the solution satisfies the same Stricker's estimate as the free equation, and I suspect that they indeed do not satisfy all of them. And so this somehow suggests why in the previous results, this case where the Schrödinger component has too much regularity was not covered. Because if you use, for example, the Brugand's XSP norm, then it implies that the solution has the full range of the Stricker's estimate automatically, as long as you choose the usual exponent. So therefore, if you want to close all the estimate just by using Brugand's space, then and if the solution does not satisfy such Stricker's estimate, then it is, of course, a difficulty. And other results concerning the local Wellposedness always using this kind of space. So this may be a kind of difficulty. But we don't know if the solution really fails to have the full range of Stricker's estimate. OK, so what about the energy space? So in this case, all the previous arguments fail because of the critical Sobolev embedding. So essentially, we have no nonlinear estimate. However, this very critical case is not like the critical case of the scalar equation, in the sense that we have actually solutions either both in a smaller function space and also in larger function space. So this is where the energy space where we have the problem. But for example, if you raise the regularity for the wave component, it's smaller, then of course we have our results. Also, if you lower the regularity for the Schrödinger component, then this is a larger space, but where we have also the local Wellposedness always, as well as the scattering, just by the previous simple argument. So this critical space is somehow in between, and this structure allows us to use the following argument. It's also a kind of classical argument by using weak compactness together with the conservation law. It's a very simple argument. So we cannot estimate in this space, but we can start with a smaller space and try to approximate the solution by a sequence of solution from there. And then by using energy and mass conservation law, assuming that the solution is small, so this is only for small solutions, the energy and mass conservation law gives us a priori bound global in HM1 and L2. Therefore, we can take the weak limit using the equation globally in time. And in general, the weak limit may have a smaller energy, but anyway, it has this inequality. And by using this larger space, we can say that this loss of energy cannot happen because we know that the limit solution is unique in this larger space. Therefore, if the energy decreases, then you can solve the equation again backward to time zero, and then you get a contradiction, right? Because the energy always decreases, and then you cannot come back to time zero. Therefore, this loss of energy cannot happen, and that means that convergence has to be strong. Therefore, the same argument works for the mass, and thus we get strong solution and also strong continuity in the energy space, and the same argument works for large time to get the scattering in the strong sense. So just by a cheap trick, we can close this part, although we have no essentially no nonlinear estimate. However, it should note that this structure alone does not tell you that the Wellposedness should hold in the intermediate space. Indeed, another corner point 2 and 3 has the same structure, but where we have a strong illposedness. Well, one reason is that we don't have the conservation law at this point. And the proof here is also pretty simple. After applying this normal form argument, we can extract somehow this transformation of the solution is actually the worst part in this special case. And then the problem is reduced to get to find initial data for which this bilinear form is worst. And it is related again because this is like you have a product and make one derivative up. It is related to this basic estimate. Also, it is related to the critical Sobolev embedding. H2 is not embedded into L infinity, therefore it's not an algebra. The product of them is not embedded into the same space. It's essentially the same for this bilinear transformation. And therefore, we can essentially choose a counterexample to this inequality with a small modification to avoid some cancellation between similar terms. But essentially, something like this, very simple, gives us a counterexample. So I stop here. Thank you.
Comments?
For the, right, in the iTeams paper on energy critical 3D Schrödinger, right, they obtained the 4 comma infinity Stricatz inequality, but by Fourier analysis, not by, right, if you, was it 4 comma 3, and then Sobolev would fail. What I'm saying is, if you try to prove an inequality by first doing Stricatz and then doing Sobolev, you fail, for example, 4 infinity Schrödinger H1 3D. But if you prove it directly, it's true. And this is observable. Okay.
Sorry, I don't get it.
I'm saying that Stricatz can hold. The result of Stricatz followed by Sobolev can hold.
Stricatz is fine, right?
Yes. But then you can't just Sobolev.
Okay.
But I'm claiming that sometimes Stricatz Sobolev is true nonetheless.
Ah, okay. Actually, it's not always together with the Stricatz. So we have this B term bilinear transform, for which we have to use directly the estimate for the, this kind of bilinear expression without any free evolution. So well, yeah, it may help, but it's not clear if we can.
Okay. Other questions, remark? In the energy space, can you do the scheme to increase your small data to...
Ah, yes, that's what we want to do. And yeah, we think probably, yeah, the natural conjecture is the... yes, the first ground state. And, but the difference from the critical Schrödinger equation is that we don't even have any nonlinear estimate in the energy space. And I guess first thing what we should do is to get a nice estimate for the Schrödinger equation, but including the wave component as a potential. Okay. And maybe we can get a nice estimate for such a Schrödinger equation with a potential, assuming that the wave component has less L2 norm than the ground state. That's what we are trying now, but...
Okay, so we use this piece. Okay. Thank you. And one more question. Okay, but this, I know the answer is no, but you haven't tried to prove blow-up, construct blow-up solution in the ground state.
yes, because we don't even have the local Wellposedness for large data. First, we need to have.
Yeah, but you can. Okay, you can.
Yeah, we may have some strange statement that we don't have either. We don't have the solution or blows up. But
you can remove a bubble when you are left with a small data again. So.
But in order to go close to the bubble, we need the existence of a solution. Right?
No, but you can work directly by on the linearized equation.
Okay. Don't we need any perturbation argument?
Yes, of course.
We don't have any estimate here.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank
Thank you.
Thank you.
Let's find the speaker again.